Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings that we have day by day, and especially, Lord, as we study the names and titles of your Son, we ask that our faith will be strengthened and that we will be more effective in serving you and giving you glory. For it is in the name of your Son we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Greg. All right. Well, today, as you can see, we are doing Wonderful Counselor. And I'll tell you, I learned just a ton on this. And I'll get to that in a minute. I do want to start with Isaiah 9, 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the trampling warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. So we have several amazing titles of our Savior given in verse 6. And in fact, we'll be covering Prince of Peace next week. But right here, Wonderful Counselor. And then notice what we've looked at already, Son of David, this idea of the throne of David being eternal, and the Messiah, the coming one, the child who is to be born, to be upon that throne and to establish it and uphold it with justice, righteousness, forever. And then I love the last line of these verses here. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Greg has mentioned many times in his sermons that the Lord has the power to do things. He is almighty. And he doesn't make mistakes, and he doesn't trick, and he is who he is, and we'll get to his unity in a moment. But he's described here as having zeal, and he is the Lord of hosts, and that means the Lord of armies, the Lord of power, and his zeal will do this. This will be accomplished. And of course, we're after the fact. We've seen this happen. We have seen Jesus do his work on the cross. We have seen the after effect of that, the church, the body of Christ, the family of God, and we are part of it. And so it is quite amazing to look back at these passages that were written before Christ, and then from our perspective, be able to see the total fulfillment of this. Today, of course, we're focusing in on Wonderful Counselor. Did want to note, a child will be born, a couple of quotes from Luke, first Luke 1, then Luke 2. The angel answered her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary said, behold, I'm the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. So again, we see that the zeal of the Lord of hosts will make these things happen. And absolutely, he will. And again, we'll look at unity of God in just a moment. But we see the Holy Spirit here. We see the Son of God here. Of course, we see God himself here. Nothing will be impossible with him. Excuse me. And then in Luke 2, in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. And at the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will make these things take place. And something we're going to see really vividly today, and I think we see this with all the names and titles of Jesus and all his works, but here especially, we're going to see the Father, Son, and Spirit working together. God is wonderful. God is a counselor, and he has done these things as God Almighty, the three of them together, if you will. He has done this through his Son. He has done this, and Jesus has done this through his Spirit. All three are wonderful. All three are counselors or advocates. And we see that clearly today. And it's an exciting thing. Deuteronomy 6, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way and when you lie down and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Mary was willing. When she was told that she would have a child, she said, I'm God's servant. Whatever needs to happen can happen. I will submit. I will comply. I'll be a willing helper, a willing servant. And we see that here. These things, the things of God should be part of every moment of life. We should allow Jesus to be our wonderful counselor. Okay, so with wonderful counselor, the Masoretic scribes understood these two words as representing one name. And that's extremely interesting. And I agree with that, of course. And almost all our versions say wonderful counselor. There are a few who put a comma between wonderful and counselor. And that makes sense grammatically as well, because they are both nouns in the Hebrew. It's not wonderful is in the Hebrew not describing the counselor. It's one of wonder, one who is a wonder, one who is a counselor. But again, the to think of them together has been the history of this, and does make sense. And that's because it is in contrast, in all likelihood, to all the ungodly counsel Israel had received or perpetuated through the kings. Some of the kings purposefully had counselors, had prophets, had people advising them who were just blatantly ungodly, were not hearing. They were false prophets. They were ones who were giving bad advice. They were ones who were terrible, ungodly counselors. But one is coming, Isaiah writes. There will be a child born who is a wonderful counselor, who is wonderful, who is a counselor. And again, it's appropriate for these to be together. And they are side by side in the Hebrew, the two nouns. So this makes sense, and this fits the context. And this is describing, of course, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the wonderful counselor. And with wonder, we'll spend a lot of our time on the word wonder. Then one of the great lessons I learned in preparing this is that wonderful is a noun. And really, the emphasis in Hebrew usually is on the first word. So I've always taken, when I see wonderful counselor, I've always taken away the main thing is that he's a counselor. The main thing is that he's an advocate, an advisor. That's the main thing. And of course he's wonderful because everything he does is wonderful. Everything God does is wonderful. But really the emphasis is on the wonder. And again, not to take anything away from God or Christ or the Spirit being counselor. Of course not. With God, everything is perfect. But wonderful is not subordinate to the counselor. Wonderful is not on some lower level in any way. And so that is really cool. And that is something that's exciting because we see that throughout Scripture. God is the God of wonders. And that's one of the emphases here. Not just being an adjective. But when we bring it into English, we don't really have any other way to say it but by saying wonderful counselor. It would be very awkward to do it any other way. And so, like I said, all the translations do it that way. And almost every one of them without a comma, a few with a comma. So let's look at the word wonderful for a good chunk here. The Hebrew word wonderful commonly denotes a quality associated with the divine. So we don't really see human beings described as people of wonder. Now the apostles, the people were in awe of them on occasion as they were of Christ when they saw miracles being done, wonderful things being done, wonders. And but still the glory was God's. And so they were advocates, they were workers for the Lord, but they never wanted the glory. Anytime that would even start to happen, they would stop the people if they would start to bow down to them or anything like that. So reserved for God and the divine. And we'll see this in a couple ways here. Note I'm giving you an 8-verse chunk, but really the word wonderful you can see is in verse 129 of Psalm 119. Greg in a couple years might get here. He's doing a couple verses from Psalm 119 a week. And of course there are 176 verses. So he's not doing every verse, but I've really appreciated those little Devo thoughts. And maybe this will be one of them eventually. Psalm 119, 129 to 136. Your testimonies are wonderful. Therefore, my soul keeps them. The unfolding of your words gives light. It imparts understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant because I long for your commandments. Turn to me and be gracious to me, as is your way with those who love your name. Keep steady my steps according to your promise, and let no iniquity get dominion over me. Redeem me from man's oppression, that I may keep your precepts. Make your face shine upon your servant and teach me your statutes. My eyes shed streams of tears because people do not keep your law. Your testimonies are wonderful. So this unity, we see that God is wonderful. God the Son is wonderful. God the Spirit is wonderful. And their collective and individual testimonies, revelations, proclamations are wonderful. When we look at the Bible, when we look at God's word, it reflects him, and it is not him, but so closely knit in Scripture. God's testimonies are wonderful. We see the first little sign of this divine use with the word wonders or wonderful in Judges 13. Manoah, these are the parents of Samson. Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, "Please let us detain you and prepare a young goat for you." And the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, "If you detain me, I will not eat your food. But if you prepare a burnt offering, then offer it to the Lord." For Manoah did not know that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, "What is your name, so that when your words come true, we may honor you?" And the angel of the Lord said to him, why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful, or wonder-filled, or full of wonder, that it is wondrous, might be a good way to put it, and maybe capitalize it. But Noah took the young goat with the grain offering and offered it on the rock to the Lord, the one who works wonders, same word. And Manoah and his wife were watching. And when the flame went up toward heaven from the altar, the angel of the Lord went up in the flame of the altar. Now Manoah and his wife were watching, and they fell on their faces to the ground. This angel had already given instructions to Manoah's wife concerning the child. And then we read right after this, Samson comes. So this is one of the first times we see this word that's used in Isaiah 9, verse 6. And concerning this angel of the Lord. Psalm 136, 4 and 5, to him who alone does great wonders, for his steadfast love endures forever. To him who by understanding made the heavens, for his steadfast love endures forever. And this psalm goes on to describe the sun and the moon and the stars. You know, it goes through creation, really. It goes through Genesis chapter 1, proclaiming the wonder of that, the amazing, and of course, the steadfast love of the Lord that goes along with his wonders and his care and grace toward us. So when we see this word wonderful, the amazing things God can do, particularly those things totally beyond our ability and comprehension, comprise his wonders and his being wonderful. Some of these quotes are from a commentary on Isaiah, and I forget the author's name, and I apologize, but I've altered them some, and these are similar things said in many commentaries, but anyway, this is really what we're looking at with this. A couple other examples, Isaiah 21 or 25, 1, O Lord, you are my God, I will exalt you, I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. Isaiah 29, 14, therefore, behold, I will do, again, wonderful things with this people, with wonder upon wonder, and the wisdom of their wise men shall perish, and the discernment of their discerning men shall be hidden. In other words, God's wonders are so profound, it makes all our earthly wisdom, all our earthly ways pale in the dust. The wisdom... this wonder is similar to this one who will come, of course, our Savior, Jesus Christ, this child that is to be born, described in Isaiah. The wisdom will be like the wisdom of Solomon and other people who have done things according to the will of the Lord. The king answered and said, give the living child to the first woman and by no means put him to death. She is his mother. And all Israel heard of the judgment that the king had rendered, and they stood in awe of the king because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to do justice. Jesus, of course, is the one we're talking about today primarily, and he was wonderful, and he performed wondrous deeds. The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and here, even those against him realized he did great things. And he healed them. But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the wonderful things that he did and the children crying out in the temple, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. They couldn't stand two things here. They couldn't stand that he was doing wonderful things, and they couldn't stand that people were giving him glory. And they said to him, do you hear what these are saying? And Jesus said, yes, have you never read, out of the mouth of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise? And leaving them, he went out of the city to Bethany and lodged there. And one more Isaiah passage. And this kind of makes our little transition from looking at wonderful to looking at counselor, although there's a lot of overlap still. But Isaiah 28, 29 says, this also comes from the Lord of hosts. He is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom. So these, and here you see the parallelism, the words wonderful and excellent, the words counsel and wisdom. None of them are exact synonyms, of course, but they go hand in hand with each other. The idea of having wonderful counsel would be very similar to being excellent in wisdom. And of course, God is the ultimate in both of these things. So the child Isaiah announced would thus possess counseling and advising ability far beyond ordinary men. Yeah, go ahead, Mom.
Well, I was just going to say, I wonder if Handel and his Messiah knew that those two words could be separate, because in the music he says, wonderful, the counselor, you know, he has them as separate. So that just came to mind.
Which song is it again? My speaker.
Handel's Messiah. Oh. Handel's Messiah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and there's nothing wrong with that at all. Like I said, uh-huh. In the Hebrew, they're both nouns. And you can talk about Jesus as the wonderful one, and you can talk about him as the counselor, and you can talk about him as the wonderful counselor. So, and
so anyway, that was just, you know.
No, that's great. And there was another song I thought of a couple days ago thinking about this. I didn't put it in. I mean, I actually a few days ago was thinking about putting the slides to the song in the lesson for us to look at. I'll try to think of what that is and maybe tack it on.
Wonderful something, rather Savior, Spirit of God. Is that it? Wonderful. I can't.
It could be. That. Yeah, there were a couple. But yeah, that might be it. That might be it. So. Yeah. Anyway, thank you though. Yeah. Very good. Very good. And then another book by Lockyer, all the divine names and titles of the divine or of God. He talks about how everything about Jesus was wonderful. His birth was wonderful. The person of Christ, who he is wonderful. He's going to mention character as well. His teaching was wonderful. His character, wonderful. His works are wonderful. His death and resurrection was wonderful. And wonderful in the sense of awe-inspired, like a wonder. These things were wonders. These things were amazing things. And his second coming, of course, will be absolutely wonderful in many different ways. All the ways we use that word. He is counselor Jesus provides, and of course every bit of counsel he provides, whether it's by scripture, by providence, or by the Spirit, no matter how it comes, it is wonderful, it is perfect, it is praiseworthy would be another way to look at that. I did really like Lockyer, what he put under the counsel being provided by providence. I just thought this was a neat little section here. I'm going to read it for you. Concurrently with scripture, and of course these things go right hand in hand. You can see that with scripture and spirit and providence. Divine providence has come in to help to guide us. We must, however, be unselfish and honest in interpreting these things and not allow ourselves to be led contrary to our convictions. I would say not allow ourselves to be led contrary to the word of the living God. We receive true counsel and are directed aright when, as children, we watch our Father, Psalm 32. All who sincerely desire heavenly counsel receive it as they believe that a divine hand controls and governs everything, Colossians 1, 16 and 17. A divine voice assures the heart that all is well, Proverbs 1, 20 and 21, Hebrews 3, 7 and 8, and a divine word is an exercise providing assurance, Job 36, 22 and Romans 8, 28. In other words, because God is the source, because God is the one providing counsel, we can count on it. Again, God is not going to lie. God is not going to trick us. God is not trying to, you know, He's not trying to condemn us. He's trying to save us, of course. So all of Christ's counsel, all of his teaching, all of his advice, if you will, all the ways he helps us, advocates for us, these things are absolutely praiseworthy. They are wonderful. And so I just took a teeny chunk here showing what Jesus is doing. Anything he teaches in all of scripture we could use to describe his great counsel, his great leading of us, his great shepherding. But here I thought I'd just give his initial statements in the Sermon on the Mount after he does the Beatitudes and the salt and light. He says, Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. Again, the unity of God himself and how that is shown in scripture. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. And this is kind of foreshadowing of his last statements. If you hear what I say and you do it, you're like a wise man who built his house upon the rock. If you hear what I say and you don't do it, you're like a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. Verse 20, for I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And then here's one example of so many here in the Sermon on the Mount, the example of anger. You've heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard, and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out till you've paid the last penny. Now remember how the people responded to all this. They were amazed. And this we read throughout the Gospels. They were amazed at his teaching. He didn't teach like these scribes and Pharisees because he was wonderful. He was a wonderful and is a wonderful counselor. So now let's look at the John passages showing how now in a very specific way, Jesus is doing this work through his spirit. So in John 14, I've got a rather lengthy chunk here. Let me look at the time. Yeah, we'll see. But in John 14, 15, and 16, this word is used. And I left the footnote, the ESV footnote in here. ESV translates it helper. But in their footnote, they note that it could be advocate or counselor. And that's really what the word, it's paraclete is the Greek word. And maybe those of you now or those of you later who are listening have heard of that word. In fact, a few English translations just put paraclete. They don't even translate it. They just, they put the Greek word transliterated. So here we are, John 14. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, implying that Jesus is our helper, that he's our counselor, he's our advocate, which we read in Isaiah 9, which we've been looking at, and he is, of course. But he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Yet a little while and the world will see me no more, but you'll see me. Because I live, you also will live. In that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. And the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. Again, the unity, that what the Father proclaims, the Son proclaims, and the Spirit helps us to live out very amazingly. These things I've spoken to you while I'm still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I'm going away and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced because I'm going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here. Part of what makes Christ wonderful and counselor, and a wonderful counselor, is that he continues to give and give and give, and that's how God is. God gives and gives and gives again, grace upon grace. Peace, the Holy Spirit, the helper, the advocate, the counselor. God just keeps on giving. John 15:26, when the helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. And then John 16, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I don't go away, the helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they don't believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father and you will see me no longer. And concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. So I want us, before we wrap up, to just remember, you know, who we're talking about today. So, and we mostly focused on Jesus, but we focused on God as a, his entirety, and God the Father. We focused some on the Spirit, because that is, he is now called very specifically with Jesus' departure. He is now the other helper, the other advocate, the other counselor. And so let's just go back to Isaiah 9, verse 6, and recognize that our Savior, the Savior, is our wonderful counselor. He is the wondrous one. He is the one who provides counsel, advice, help. He's the one that moves us through. And quite an amazing title. Of course, that's the first one there in Isaiah 9, 6. And names in scripture, and I would say particularly the Old Testament, they had deep meanings. And of course, any name or title given to God, the Father, Son, or Spirit, has significance. God would not allow a name or a title to be used for him that was not extremely important, descriptive, and helpful to us in our walk. The very last passage I want us to look at is the fact that God is supreme. And we'll see, you know, who can be God's counselor? the depth and of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. And so, Greg, I know that you can word some of those things a little better or add something in here. So please go ahead. And then, Mom, if you have anything too, that'd be great.
Well, Clayvon, I think you did a great job with this. Find it interesting that closely allied with the concept of that which is wondrous is that which is gracious. And the fact that who can be God's counselor? Well, no one can. Well, who can show grace to God? Well, no one can. Grace comes from God. And the wonders that he performs for us are putting us in a position of receiving. And this is true in all of life, but especially in the guidance he provides so that we walk with him. That's why we're called to keep in step with the Spirit. Mm-hmm. Or we think in terms of walking with Jesus, as would be predicted in the 23rd Psalm, his leading, his guiding. And while I think it's useful to rely on all kinds of human wisdom for appropriate things, we must never permit human wisdom to supplant our reliance through faith in the grace of God as revealed in Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fabulous. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Mom, anything? Or Dad? I see Mom's name, and but Dad's there too.
He's there too.
Yep.
He's there too.
Amen.
So no, I don't have anything okay. else, but it was a great lesson.
If you'll keep your mic on, Dad, will you lead a prayer as we close out?
Will you lead a please? Prayer?
Father, we thank you for being with us today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your love. And in Jesus' name, amen.
I'm going to, at this time, add in some songs that are special and maybe relate to what we talked about today. I couldn't find the one my mom was mentioning, or at least I don't think I did, but let's take a look at a few of these. This one's called A Son Is Given. People who dwell in the land of the shadow of darkness have seen a great light. For unto us a child is born, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. Sing Alleluia, a son is given. Alleluia, 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 Alleluia. 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 Let us exalt him, lift up his praises, his wonderful deeds of old. He has done marvelous, glorious things. All people on earth shall glory bring. Sing Alleluia, a son is given. And then the praise Alleluia for the 9 times again. Then a song called Wonderful, Wonderful, Wonderful Jesus is to me. Counselor, Prince of Peace, Mighty God is He. Saving me, keeping me from my sin and shame. Wonderful is my Redeemer, praise His name. Then Wonderful, Merciful Savior. Wonderful, Merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, comforter, keeper, spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty Infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. We truly have an amazing Savior, and we look forward to seeing you next week as we cover the Prince of Peace.